5'7", 5'8". We got him up very quickly today due to the superb computer research that we've got here and the workings of the computer system that have been developing all these points. David, what'd you think?
Well, I was a little bit tired tonight. I felt pretty good. A few things went a little wild, but I was happy to hit the flip and hopefully do a little better at Worlds.
Well, here's the artistic impression, 5'7", 5'2", from East, 5'5", rather, from the second judge, East Germany, and you see the marks rest across the line there. Congratulations to you, David.
Thank you.
And so the questions remain. Has Robin Cousins passed Jan Hofman in the standings? Can Charlie Tickner here pass both of them? It's almost impossible. He would have to have some sixes on the board, almost certainly perfect marks to do it, but we have seen sixes before. Charles Tickner of Littleton, Colorado, originally from California, 26 years old. He's had a long uphill battle, and it all comes here.
You said he had to have sixes. There are space according to the ordinal placings in the marking system so far. There is room for Charlie Tickner.
Okay.
That does it right there. It will not necessarily keep him off the podium, but I think it will be very hard for him to beat out Robin Cousins and Jan Hofman at this point.
intended to be a triple loop. He was free to reduce it to a double, but the fallout of it did not help. Well-rounded program for Charlie Tiffany. The choreographic content of the program really, really well put together, complete, treated as a whole program, not just a series of double and triple jumps interconnected with a lot of interconnected steps. Beautiful, beautiful overall performance, I think, by him from that point of view.
But two mistakes there that may prove his undoing as far as trying to move past the two men in front of him. Coming to you live from the Winter Olympic Games in Lake Placid. We'll be back for Charlie Tickner's March, of course.
For artistic impression, again, a 5'6", rising to a 5'7", and a 5'8", and a 5'6", again, for judge number five, that's from France, 5'8", across the line. What do you think, Charlie?
Well, I got pretty tired. I don't know if it was because it's so warm in here, and the maybe I had to wait so long before I skated. My legs got tired very quickly, and they just got really kind of burning.
I got to tell you, you move beautifully. It's all put together, and it's a wonderful, wonderfully complete program that you skate.
Well, thank you very much. I was pleased I did the triple lutz, and I don't know, I think maybe I put too much emphasis on it.
Well, I was as much pleased to see that you put all those spirals and spread eagles in such terrific order and have the, such the completeness about the whole program, and I thought that was exciting.
Well, thank you. That's the way I like to do it, is have a complete program. But
well, I got to tell you something before you go anyway, any way further. You've got the bronze medal.
Well, thank you. Thank you very much. Any medal, as I said before, I think there was a lot of pressure on all the U.S. skaters, you know, because they kept saying we're going to get golds, we're going to get golds, and I think it was very hard for us to perform. I didn't really think about it, but I think I've been saying all along I would be very happy with any medal because, as you know, the Olympic Games are a pretty special event, and to be in the top three is even better. So,
well, you got a medal, the first medal won outside of speed skating in this Winter Olympic Games. Congratulations, Charlie Tiffany. It was really a sensational job.
Thank you very much, Dick.
And here we have the official results, the winner of the gold medal from Great Britain for the second straight Olympics, from that country for the second straight Olympics, Robin Cousins. He passed Jan Hofman and did it. Jan Hofman, in his fourth Olympics, wins his first medal. It is a silver one. Charlie Tiffany, in probably his only Olympics, wins a bronze medal. And you heard him say it, that any medal at all would be good enough for him. Well, he has done it, so each of those three has achieved something. In fourth place, David Santee, who's achieved a tremendous amount in the last 8 or 9 months in motivating himself. Scott Hamilton, who has come on like a skyrocket in the last year in world figure skating. The United States placing third, fourth, and fifth in the Olympic Games figure skating. Igor Bobrin of the Soviet Union, as you see, is in sixth position. A very satisfactory finish for many people, really. A lot of satisfaction to be enjoyed. We have more to come on our Olympic coverage from Lake Placid, New York. Coming up right now, we're going to have an ABC news brief and a word from our local stations. Placid is in the big town of North Elba. That's the way it is, and the town hall is the same one they had here in 1932. So we've seen the men's figure skating championship determined live, but there is more. You may have forgotten in all the excitement out at the arena that a young man named Eric Heiden of Madison, Wisconsin, was due to skate again today. The men's 1,500 meters in speed skating, just across the street from the town hall, on the speed skating rink in front of the high school. Let's go now to Keith Jackson's report.
The men's 1,500 meters, 3 3/4 laps, a staggered start at the head of the back straight, around to the finish. The world record at 1,500 meters held by Eric Heiten, United States, 154.79. The Olympic record, Jan Egil Stoholt, Norway, 159.38. Both the world record holder and the Olympic record holder will participate in this event today. Hello, everybody. I'm Keith Jackson. And this event really doesn't need much dramatization. You're about to see one of those rare moments in sport where an athlete can achieve a first, become the first man ever to do something. That man, of course, is Eric Heiden of Madison, Wisconsin, who today can win his fourth successive gold medal in men's speed skating. Nobody's ever done it in these modern times. The heat's on it. Let's talk about that with Sheila Young-Okowitz, our expert commentator. What about Eric Heiden? How is he prepared, you think, for this event today, at this moment in athletic history?
Well, because the competitions have been drawn out over such a long period, it becomes more difficult to really get psyched up and maintain concentration.
He has sort of become the target for the rest of the skaters, though. They have to be almost prepared to be suicidal in the effort to stop his string of gold medals.
I think that's really helped them to have someone so fantastic to shoot for. It's probably been giving them the opportunity to skate beyond their limits.
The weather, mild, but high humidity.
The ice conditions still look good, though, and I expect to see some fast times.
Eric Heiden right there, still in his warm-ups, getting ready for his race. He's not racing first. He'll have a chance to judge early skaters. Our first pairing, Masahiko Yamamoto of Japan, his second Olympics. He was 21st in this event in 1976. The Olympic record holder and defending champion is Jan Egil Storholt. He'll be wearing the red. 31-year-old Norwegian. He is from Trondheim. 1976. 159.38 to win the 1,500 meters. He was 17th in the 1,000 meters on Tuesday. This is the first pair off the start line. All the other competitors going about their disciplines, preparing, getting ready, waiting to see what kind of a time this man, Storholt, will put on the top of the board. The start is good. 3 3/4 laps will have split times at 300, 700, and 1100 meters.
It's very important in the 1500 meters to get a good start, get the fast tempo going, and then to sort of settle into your pace.
We expect the Olympic record in this event will be kicked around just as it has been in all of the other events. All the Olympic records have fallen in speed skating thus far, and very quickly, Storholt, on a heady pace, goes out to a lead.
They both had a very good opener. From now on, they're going to be trying to do 30-second laps and then dropping down to about 31-second laps.
The Japanese skater Yamamoto on the inner lane. The Norwegian skater Storholt skating the outer right now.
55.31 for Storholt, 56.09 for Yamamoto.
Split time.
That was a very good split time. Right now, they're on a record that would bring them below the Olympic record, about a 157.
Storholt moving now to the inner. Skating very well. As he comes past the line this time, he'll hear the ringing of the bell to tell him he's got 400 meters to go. Increasing the pressure. Still, however, maintaining the single arm swing. But now the left arm starts to drop a little bit as he comes off the turn. However, he tucks it back up on his back. But you could certainly see very quickly that he put more pressure on himself. He drove harder into the ice. The stroke became firmer. And coming around off the last turn, Jan Egil Storholt. Remember, the Olympic record is 159.38. And Storholt, at the finish, stops the clock at 157.95, and he has broken his own Olympic record for Yamamoto, 201.25. 157.95. Maybe not as quick as some of us thought he might skate today, but still, a good time for this 31-year-old veteran from Trondheim, Norway.
He has very good technique. Here you can see he has an excellent arm swing. When you're skating, you try to think as if you had a bowling ball in your hand and you were rolling it down the alley.
Working as an electrician a few years ago, he was involved in an explosion in a mine. He was burned, he lost part of his hearing, but he has stayed with his sport and he has performed admirably. Here in the 1980 Winter Olympics. Jan Egil Storholt. Hosting a tough time to beat. Still, you'll try to do in this 1,500 meter run.
Well, the 1,500 is, it's kind of like the 1,000 meters, but you have to hold back a little bit. You'll open up as hard as you can. The next lap, you'll relax, and then the next two laps, you'll go hard.
Sister, Beth Hyden, obviously at the track. Bronze medal winner yesterday at 3,000 meters. She'll cheer loud and long for her brother. Now the call to the starting line for Erik Hyden, skating with him, a very good one from Norway, Kai Arne Stenshemmet, an old foe, an old friend. Stenshemmet, 26 years of age right there, took a silver medal in the 5,000. Of course, Erik Hyden has won the gold in the 500, the 5,000, and the 1,000, all Olympic record times. Starter, Mulder, sends him off on the first gun. Hyden digging, crowd starting to roar, and they will roar the whole time. This remarkable young man is on the ice. Stenshemmet will push him. We know that. Erik Hyden, however, self-possessed, poised, knows his target. Truth, one of the outstanding athletes of his generation, maybe one of a kind.
It was a very fast opener.
Listen now for his coach, Diane Holloway. Inside now, Erik Hyden. Hyden started on the outer. Skating the inner right now. You can see that Stenshemmet is right with him, and he almost fell down. He almost fell coming off that turn.
That must have shaken him up an awful lot, and it's going to take a lot of concentration to try and get it all back together again.
53.75 on his slip. Listen. Diane just gives him a hand signal. That slip crushed him.
The hand signal that she was giving him was an indication that he was underneath his schedule, and he went on a 155 schedule. He's still going very fast.
157.95, the time to beat. Hyden is on the outside. 157.95, the time to beat. The bell lap. 124.11, the 1100 meter split. Encouragement from his coach, Diane Holland, as Erik Hyden is on the inner lane, coming down off the final turn. Slipped there a moment ago. This time he handles it very well. Here's the drive. Watch the time. Well, you can see it. He just missed his world record. Despite the slip in the turn, Erik Hyden puts a 1.5544 on top of the board. 1.5681 for Stenshemmet. Erik Hyden, an incredible athlete of his generation. Somebody conceivably could top that before this competition is done. But that, I will tell you, is a powerful set of numbers. 1.5544. And remember, he was so close to falling. Here's a look in slow motion at the start of Erik Hyden, the man in gold.
He had a very good start. He's so powerful. He explodes off the line, taking big steps forward and pushing out to the side.
His lifestyle being changed steadily during these Olympic Games. Pressure on him growing and growing and growing. But he's fighting off that pressure and performing brilliantly. And here is the slip coming down off the turn that almost took him out of the race. See that? So close to going down. So close to being taken out of it. Incredible velocity, momentum for this man coming off these turns. And another look at what was almost disaster for him.
It looked like he caught his outside edge.
You have to be strong. You have to be composed in order to handle a moment like that, where hundredths of a second mean the difference between winning and losing. Well, Hyden handled it. And his time right now, 155.44,
the time to beat. You're looking at Terje Andersen of Norway, Tom Plant of the United States. This pair, Plant on the inner, Andersen on the outer, at the start. This is Tom Plant's only race in these Olympics. Tom Plant, who performed very well, surprisingly well, in the World Sprints, would dearly love to lay down a good time here and take home a medal. Tom Plant wants to skate on beyond these Olympic Games, perhaps even till 1984. Tom starting on the inner. Looks strong. He's certainly out on the ice with a good competitor in Andersen. Andersen was 12th in the 1,000.
Good opener for both skaters.
Diane Hollum talking to Tom Plant as he goes by for the first time. Eric Heiden, 155.44. Tim Chinnick, 156.81.
Tom looks like he's having a little problem in his corner. He slipped twice on that last turn.
.53.75 for Eric Heiden at 700 meters. Split times for these two skaters you see there.
Him because he has somebody to shoot for to pick up his pace down the backstretch.
Gotta be hard though to have one event to skate. Really gotta be hard on you to get yourself organized totally for the one trip onto the ice. Tom Plant and Terje Andersen. Plant's got a shot at beating. Oh no! He almost fell down. He lost his balance in the turn and he almost fell down.
Andersen looks very good in this race, though. He's holding together his technique and skating very strong.
That mistake coming out of the turn cost Tom Plant dearly. Terje Andersen is going to finish well in front of him. Tom Plant not going to have a chance at a medal. Andersen, 1.5692. Tom Plant, 2.0057. 1.5692 for Terje Andersen. The Norwegians are looking very strong. You know that? They may get themselves a couple of medals out of this 1,500-meter event. Eric Heiden's time, though, of 1.5544, almost untouchable. Here's Tom Plant and some of the troubles that he had.
It was hard to tell exactly what happened. Through the whole race, he looked a little unsteady.
Here's the second one now, where I thought for a second he was going to fall. Right there. Big lean. Literally had to stop to regain his balance, and he could never recover from it. So, the time of Andersen at 1.5692 moves him into third place, into bronze medal position. So the standings right now, Eric Heiden, Bjarnis Stenshemmet, and Terje Andersen.
For Charlie Tickner of the United States receiving his bronze medal in the Olympic Games. His first Olympics, as we said, almost unquestionably his last at age 26. He's shaking the hands of Robin Cousins. Now the national anthem, we've actually heard it for the second time tonight here. The first time it was played for Liechtenstein. As Baron von Falzfein said, they borrowed it from England because they don't have a composer of their own. But for Robin Cousins, what a moment. His fellow countryman, John Curry, heard it 4 years ago. Now it's for him. To the Olympics to compete, but it's quite seldom really that they have the opportunity to see their flag raised and their anthem played. For Charlie Tickner, a bronze, and he says he's happy. For Robin Cousins, the gold.
All that jazz, it's about the kids who have it. and the ones who don't.
Solemn competition. Both the first and second runs take place tomorrow. Ingemar Stenmark again. In hockey, what were the odds before this tournament began that the United States and the Soviet Union would meet as undefeated teams? That's the story. The U.S. tied once, but unbeaten. They play, and you'll see them tomorrow night on this program. Also going to have a special visit and a special performance by the 1968 gold medalist in women's figure skating, beautiful Peggy Fleming. Peggy Fleming tomorrow night, along with all the rest of our coverage that will begin at 8:30 Eastern and Pacific time. Coming up after your local news at 11:30, continuing Olympic coverage, and that's going to be also with...
If you missed the recent Delco battery sale, here's great news.
We should have coming at the Olympics in a game that we've all been waiting for. Tonight you'll see the United States hockey team take on the Soviet Union. The Americans, young amateurs, averaging about 22 years of age. The Soviets generally acknowledged to be the greatest hockey team in the world, bar none. On White-Faced Mountain, we'll watch Sweden's Ingemar Stenmark try for his second gold medal of the games in the two-run slalom competition. For the United States, the slalom represents a last chance for a medal. Phil Mayer is the best hope, coming back from a bad injury. It's Winter Olympics time.
Winter Olympic Games. Brought to you by Chevrolet, who congratulates the athletes of the world who've made it to the 1980 Winter Olympics. By Metropolitan. Metropolitan really stands by you with insurance for your life, health, auto, home, and retirement. And by Owens Corning Fiberglass Corporation, makers of fine fiberglass products for consumers and industry.
I'm Jim McKay reporting to you live from Lake Placid, New York, and the picture behind me is also live on Main Street, Lake Placid. From the time these Olympics began, we tried to report them to you in perspective. We've told you about the unpleasant things, the politics and the transportation and so forth. We've also tried to show you the excitement of victory and the disappointment of the other athletes on the hills and on the skating rinks. It's very important tonight, I think, to tell you that from the time I went out of my hotel at 11 o'clock this morning and walked down Main Street, there's a feeling of joy and anticipation and excitement in this town like nothing we have seen before at these Winter Olympics. It's just tremendous. It's as if the whole country has come to a county fair, except that the whole world is here. Now, the events you're going to be seeing tonight both have been completed. It may be that many millions of you know the result. However, we said at the beginning we would not tip the result of something to you before we show it to you. We're going to follow that policy tonight because if there's only one person in this country who doesn't know how these two events turn out, I'm not going to be the one to tell it to them. We've had mail, we've had phone calls from people saying that that is the way the vast majority of you want to have it. So the events you're going to be seeing tonight are the men's slalom up on White-Faced Mountain, the ice hockey game between the United States and the Soviet Union. Right now, with the crowd behind us in Main Street, Lake Placid, we're going to take a brief break, then come back. It's going to be a night. Well, before we go to Al Michaels and Ken Dryden, we might set the situation for you just a little bit. Before the game between the United States and the Soviet Union, scalpers outside the arena were selling tickets for $150 and up. The mood, as I said, was of anticipation and excitement. And let's set the situation as they came into this game. Now, remember that there were two divisions, the red and the blue. Four teams advanced, two from each division. Now, you take your record against the other team in your division that gets into the Final Four with you. In other words, the United States and Sweden tied when they played earlier. They're both in the Final Four, so they each go in with a tie or 1 point. The Soviet Union defeated Finland, whom you see at the bottom there, in their earlier competition. Therefore, the Soviet Union goes into the competition with 2 points, and Finland goes in with none. The United States must play the Soviet Union and then Finland. They do not play Sweden again. So that's the situation as the final round of four began. Right now, we're going to begin our coverage of this game between the Soviet Union and the United States. Remember 1960? They were trying for it again.
The excitement, the tension building, the Olympic Center filling to capacity. The face value of a top ticket for tonight's game, $67.20. Outside, they're exchanging hands at three times the face value. Hello again, everybody. I'm Al Michaels, along with Ken Dryden. It should be a great night. I'm sure there are a lot of people in this building who do not know the difference between a blue line and a clothesline. It's irrelevant. It doesn't matter, because what we have at hand, the rarest of sporting events, an event that needs no buildup, no superfluous adjectives. In a political or nationalistic sense, I'm sure this game is being viewed with varying perspectives, but manifestly, it is a hockey game. The United States and the Soviet Union on a sheet of ice in Lake Placid, New York. Ken, some of your thoughts before the game.
Well, Al, for the U.S. team, it's really discovery time. It's one thing to be young and promising, and it's quite another to be good. And in the next 2.5 hours, the U.S. team players will go through perhaps the most difficult and demanding yet exhilarating time of their lives. They will be playing against a very good team, a team that's better than they are. And after that time, after it's all over, this team will find out an awful lot about themselves. They'll simply find out how good they are.
Here we go as the game is underway. The Soviet Union in red and the United States in white. The U.S. finishing second in the blue division. The Soviets on top in the red division. Jim Craig again in the nets for the United States. Vladislav Tretiak in the nets for the Soviet Union. Some consider him the best goalie in the world. The Americans start back the other way. Davey Schultz up ahead. McClanahan can't control. Number 17, the veteran. Harlamov, the top Soviet line out there right now. But they have four lines, almost equal in balance, in strength, and veteran unit. Morrow touching the puck back of the American net. The icing call and the faceoff in the Soviet end.
Well, I think even in that first shift, we had a little bit of a glimpse of what the U.S. team is going to try to do. When the Soviet team gains possession of the puck, they're going to try to be very deliberate with it when they have the time. Under those circumstances, the U.S. team is going to back off and try to move into their defensive zone with all five men so they don't get outnumbered.
Chavlet centering the line for the Americans out there right now. Number 28 is Harrington from the Duluth branch of the University of Minnesota, but it's taken away by Zlukov to Balderas with great individual skills. Number 19, and back into the Soviet end. So Balderas trying to get it back to Starikov, but Vasiliev has to go back to get it. Number 6 for the Soviet Union. Up ahead is Zlukov, number 22. Zlukov at center ice to Vasiliev into the corner. He's checked in there by Davey Christian. Vasiliev picks up the loose puck. There's Zlukov. Zlukov in on Craig. A save by Jim. Stops the rebound. And the whistle for the faceoff. So Craig tested for the first time and equal to the task.
A very big save by Jim Craig this early in the game. Zlukov went back to the defensive position. Here's Zlukov coming in from the point. Vasiliev is in the corner, the normal defenseman. And he comes in and Craig moves out, cuts the angle, covers his ground, and the rebound.
Broughton on the faceoff for the U.S. Ramsey clearing it back of his own net to Kenny Morrow out of Bowling Green. Ramsey trying to work it along the board. Up ahead to Arruzioni, but kept in by the tenacious Soviets. Makarov, number 24, who plays on the line with the Golikov brothers. Their numbers are 23 and 25. Out in front. And Broughton was able to get his stick on it. Off the shot by Golikov. The Americans getting it back to center zone, but the Soviets taking control there as Golikov, Vladimir Golikov, number 25, over the red line to Makarov. He skates in over the blue line. Nice pass up ahead to Makarov, his brother. And out in front comes Tomorrow now for the U.S. The Americans having trouble getting the puck out of their own end. Craig being tested early. The Americans now trying to work it up ice. Ramsey, number 5. Nice pass to Wells, but Wells can't get a stick on it to backhand it. Pervukin moving it out along the board. Lebedev checked hard by Strobel. Makarov skating in over the blue line, number 24. Makarov.
It's a dangerous play by Makarov. Defenseman Mike Ramsey gave him simply too much space.
Strobel able to clear it to center ice. Mark Wells, number 15. Wells shooting it into the Soviet end. Back of the cage. Rakota centers it out in front. But Kasatinov was there. He clears it up ice. They wave off the icing call. Baker is back to get it. Bill Baker. That goal with 27 seconds against Sweden on opening night. The big play for the U.S. Followed by the win over Czechoslovakia. Rakota. His shot is saved by Tretiak after the great pass from Baker in the corner. So Tretiak, the first time he is tested, able to make the save.
Darn, the sink's clogged with hair. Honey, get the liquid Drano.
Elaine, use new liquid Drano with formula Oxide 3.
You? Oxide only three?
It dissolves hair three times faster than before, so drains run better.
Great! Will it hurt my pipes?
No!
Here's the liquid drain opener, honey.
We use new liquid drainer with formula oxide 3, honey. Dissolves hair three times faster than before.
A1 steak sauce?
On your hamburger?
My friends, what is hamburger? Chopped ham?
Oh.
It's chopped steak. And what's better on steak than A1? A1 makes hamburgers taste like steak burgers.
This I gotta try.
A1's herbs and spices blend with the meat's natural juices, make it juicy and tastier.
It is tastier.
Best hamburger I ever had.
Sure, A1 makes every bite count.
A1 makes hamburgers taste like steak burgers.
Your Olympic station, Channel 24.
The Americans nothing and the Soviets nothing. With Mark Johnson centering the line for the U.S. at the moment. Into the Soviet zone with Fedosov. Catching up along the board. Krutov trying to clear it into the American end. Kept into the neutral zone by Ramsey. Satanov shooting it around the board. Prey got to get a piece of the stick on it. Davey Silk scrapping for it in the corner. Pushes it along the boards with his skates. And now Ramsey with a puck for the United States. Soviets coming back the other way. In over the blue line. Lebedev taken out of the play as Davey Silk goes back to get the loose puck. Now McClanahan. And McClanahan getting it back to center ice. Fedosov, number two. To Malta. Malta picked up at the blue line. The Americans doing that well thus far against the Soviets. Buzz Snyder losing it. Out to the point. Slap shot, and it was deflected in from the point. The Soviet Union takes a 1-0 lead. Kasatkina's slap shot was deflected in past Craig. And the Soviet Union leads 1-0 at the 9:12 mark of the first period.
A very harmless looking play. The puck getting away from Buzz Snyder to the point. A very easy shot that you can see in front. It's deflected by Krutov and to the lower glove hand side of Craig.
So the Soviet Union leading 1-0. O'Callaghan can't control as the Soviets apply the pressure. Golikov, number 23, along with Makarov, scrapping for the puck, and back it comes to the Soviet end. Valerie Vasiliev, number 6. Golikov now, passing back to his brother who can't control, Buzz Snyder, Harrington, Pavlich, tries to get it out in front, but the Soviets are able to clear. The Americans can't get anybody in the middle.
The U.S. team is going to have to skate a little bit more. They've got to apply more pressure in the Soviet zone. If they play the game in the U.S. zone, there are going to be a lot of goals scored.
Soviet Union leading 1-0. We're at the halfway mark of the first period. Alexander Golikov, number 23. Golikov, 27 years old. The Soviets with a lot of experience. Slap shot goes wide. Golikov, the save by Craig. And O'Callaghan trying to pin it against the boards, and now we get the whistle. The referee tonight, Carl Gustav Keisler from Finland. The line winner from Canada and Holland.
I think that if the U.S. team has any model that they would like to follow in this game, it's the second period that they played against Czechoslovakia about a week ago. They were strong offensively. They pressured the Czechoslovakian team, but they weren't indiscriminate about it. When they were in trouble, they backed off very well and defended extremely well.
Craig making the stick save off the shot by Pervukin. Now Broughton for the U.S. Broughton with Kristoff, but Kristoff can't get the shot away. Broughton keeping it in the Soviet end, again centering it out in front, but Delia Lekhanov there for the Soviet Union, up along the board. The Soviets clearing the zone. Pervukin, number 5, long shot is wide. And Broughton, back of his own net. Neal skating out with it. Broughton up the center ice, but Pervukin is there for the Soviet Union. Sportsov trying to shoot it into the American end. And now Ramsey up along the boards to Kristoff. Kristoff leaving it for Broughton. Broughton and Pervukin strapping for the puck in the corner. Valderas now clearing it along the far board. And Sportsov gets it back to center ice. The crowd thus far, quite in contrast to that emotional game with Czechoslovakia, rather quiet.
I think the crowd is perhaps a little bit like the team out there. Everybody's just a little bit tight. They need something to happen to loosen up.
Exactly. And the Americans, with very little offense thus far, have not given them much to cheer about. The Soviets leading 1-0. Rakota starts back the other way, but losing it at center ice. Zluchtov. Christian. Baby number 23. And now Fedosov able to clear the zone. So we'll have an icing call here as Baker goes back to get it. And with 8:03 to play in the first period, the Soviet Union leading the United States 1-0. The Soviet Union 1, the United States 0. 12 minutes into the first period. Christian's slap shot was deflected in front. Davey, number 23. Johnson getting it back out to Dave Schultz from Boston University. The Soviets trying to clear the zone now as Harlamov passing up to center ice, but Baker keeps it back in, and then McClanahan is offside.
The irony of the U.S. play so far is that they've been very conscious of not being outnumbered by the Soviets, who are extremely quick, and they play much like a basketball fast break game, where they'll get out of their zone quickly, try to outnumber their opponents 3-on-2 or 2-on-1, and score. The U.S. team is getting back with 3 and 4 people, but there's so many there that nobody's picking anybody up. And at the same time, they're not pressing offensively.
The Soviet Union scoring at the 9-12 mark of the first period. They gave the goal to Kasatnov, but as we can see on the replay, it was tipped in by Krutov, so they'll probably change that after the period. Davy Schultz, number 8. And the Soviets controlling again now as Starikov comes in over the blue line. It's racked up tomorrow there.
Notice there again, there are 3 or 4 U.S. players right on the blue line to meet the Soviet team. If they can continue to do that, they're going to give the Soviets a lot of trouble, but they've got to also apply some pressure in the other end and when the occasion arises.
They have not done that. Johnson that time trying to split the defense with a couple of wings on either side. And the Soviets bring it back into the American end. Krutov scrapping for it with Morrow. The Soviets able to get it loose now. Krutov to Maltsev, number 10. Maltsev passing in front. The shot hit the side of the net. The Americans able to clear it along the boards, but kept in by Vasiliev at the point. Lebedev got it out in front, but Davy Silk then clears it to center ice.
Well, we've only played about 14 minutes in the game, and already Krutov, the 19-year-old junior player for the Soviets, has been very much in evidence, as he has been all this Olympic tournament. He scored the goal, and he's threatened every time he's been on the ice.
Krutov thus far in the tournament with 4 goals and 4 assists. Each of the Soviets have scored at least 1 goal in the tournament thus far, outside of Pervukin, number 5, a defenseman. Pavlich taking it away for the U.S. Pavlich up ahead to Schneider. Shot goes in! Bud Schneider! That's the type of goal you don't expect somebody like Tretiak to give up. And the United States ties the game at 14:03 in the period.
Well, once again, it's Pavlich and Schneider combining. A long shot from a fairly severe angle, catching Tretiak in the top glove side. He's well out, he's in good position, although he was moving a little bit in the opposite direction to where the shot went. Here we can see it again in the top corner. Tretiak has been struggling a bit of late. He let in 2 bad goals against Canada the other day, and there's some suspicion that he really is not in very good form at this point.
Bud Schneider, the only man to play in 76 in Innsbruck. And what a tournament he has had. That's Buzz's 5th goal in this, the 6th game for the United States. They came out of the initial round 4-0-1. The Soviets were 5-0. The Soviets trying to clear. Kasatnov, number 7, up ahead. Now Balderas skates in over the blue line to Skvortsov. Skvortsov gets by Christian. Craig makes the save. And then the rebound goes wide. 5.5 minutes to play in the first period. We're tied. There's Zluchtov out in front. The shot is wide. Kasatnov backhanding it in from the point to the near side now. Bud Schneider, number 25, is tied up with Skvortsov. So 5:13 to go in the first period. There's the man who tied it up, Bud Schneider. The U.S. won and the Soviets won.
Snyder also made a very good play there by holding the puck for the faceoff. The U.S. team getting in trouble again. The same problem. It's not a factor of not getting their players back, but it's almost as if they don't know what to do with the luxury of numbers.
The Soviets, the shot by Harlamov and the glove save off the faceoff by Craig.
So that shot was from about 40 feet. It was a wrist shot from Harlamov. It probably wasn't all that fast, but it was a very tough save because Harlamov released it very quickly and it was going right into the lower glove-hand corner.
One big difference between these two teams, that line out there right now for the Soviets, as Arruzioni goes over to the bench to get a new stick. The line currently on the ice for the Soviets, centered by Petrov with Mikhailov and Harlamov on the wings. They've played together as a unit for 9 years. In 72, they were there in Sapporo, in 76 in Innsbruck, and here they are in Lake Placid. The Americans, just 22-year average age of the entire unit, and only Snyder with previous Olympic experience. Kristoff skating in. Arruzioni tried to get his stick on it and put it, and then the shot is blocked out in front. Kristoff losing it in the corner to Petrov, but getting it back now. Rotten. Back around the boards to Kristoff. And the Soviets clearing it up the center ice now, but Ramsey with control of it. Over to Kenny Morrow, number three. Morrow, very steady and consistent throughout the Olympics. Kristoff checking Vasiliev, and then Morrow losing it at center ice. Petrov up ahead to Mikhailov, and then back it comes to center zone. Arruzioni, number 21. He's had a great tournament thus far. Mike, the team captain. The icing call waved off as Ramsey got there first, and now Harlamov for the Soviet Union. Pressured by Strobel. Strobel able to keep it in, take it away. Strobel along the board, getting some help now from Prokota. Prokota getting tied up along with Petrov, and it's frozen there with 3:59 to play in the first period. The United States won, and the Soviet Union won. 3:19 to play. We're in the first period. The United States won, and the Soviet Union won. Buzz Snyder scoring for the U.S. They gave the goal to Gasakhanov for the Soviet Union, despite the fact Krutov was the man who tipped it in. The Soviets coming into the Meadowland play with 2 points. The U.S. with one. Davy Silk has it taken away. Golikov passing over to his brother, number 25. And Makarov's shot, the save by Craig. Back out to center ice it comes. Makarov skating in over the blue line. Makarov passing back to Golikov. He can't get a stick on it. And Davy Silk with a puck for the U.S. Silk passing up ahead, too far from the front of hand. The Robin grabbing the board in the corner, losing it there as Golikov comes back the other way for the Soviet Union. Golikov, number 23, leaving it to Makarov. He tried to get it back to Golikov, then gets it back and scores. Deflected off the American defenseman, and the Soviets take the lead 2-1.
Well, perhaps their two most dangerous scorers have been the goal scorers so far, and that's Krutov and Makarov. Here it is. The Makarov tries to make the pass into the corner. It hits a skate, comes right back to him. By that point, Jim Craig is starting to go down, and there's the shot into the top corner. Again, the U.S. team has plenty of defenders back, but they've got to go on the puck carrier a lot more decisively than they have.
That one deflected back off the skate of Kenny Morrow. It's 2-1 Soviet Union with 2:20 remaining in the first period. Helmut Balderas, number 19, perhaps more of an individual player than any of the other Soviets. Saved by Craig, and the save again off the rebound.
Excellent save by Craig on the original shot and on the rebound.
Harrington trying to get it out for the U.S. Harrington, who played with Pavlich at Minnesota Duluth. Pavlich working on the same line with him during the Olympics, along with Buzz Snyder. This is the line that accounted for the U.S. score earlier in the period. The Soviets leading 2-1 as Baker controls now, back at his own blue line. Ramsey and Pavlich couldn't get his stick down to take the pass to the Soviets. Zhukov trying to clear it, but Snyder keeps it in, and he drops the pass to the point, but only Balderas is there. The Soviets back in over the blue line. Glukov, number 22, out in front. Vasiliev's shot swept aside. Starikov. Skvortsov, back of the net, number 26. And Ramsey starts to get into it with Balderas. Schwarzkopf also involved in the play as we have a whistle, stopping the action with 1:13 to go in the period.
The U.S. team is having something of the same problem that Canada had the other day. Canada was forcing the play very effectively on the Soviets, but when they would get into trouble in their own zone, they seemed to be unable to clear the zone when they had an opportunity. The opportunities have been there for the U.S. team many times to get the puck out, and if you don't do it, you just run into second and third chances, and the Soviets don't need them.
It's interesting. The United States really yet to have a good first period in any of the games in this tournament. Remember the Norway game last Saturday, trailing 1-0 after the first. And again, that's basically the case thus far tonight. The Soviet Union leading 2-1 as Craig makes the save off the shot by Mikhailov.
Those are the kinds of saves that if the U.S. team can come back, they will be very memorable later in the game because they're big saves. They're preventing the gap from opening up.
Broughton up ahead on the 2-on-1. Broughton, and it goes through the crease. It was deflected, but Broughton gets it back. Tries to center it. Petrov scrapping for it. Broughton keeping it in. 43 seconds to play in the first period as the Soviets clear it down the ice. Christian back to get it for the United States. Half a minute now remaining in the first period. Up ahead of Ruggioni. Broughton along with Pavukin. Ruggioni now out at the point. 19 seconds. It's blocked in front. Kristoff can't get his stick on it. And the Soviets able to clear it to the side. 12 seconds remaining in the period. The scoring, it's been changed. They've given the goal, as we saw in the replay, to Krutov for the Soviet Union. That made it 1-0. Long shot, the easy save by Tretiak, but Johnson is there and scores with 1 second to play in the period. Right now, the clock shows nothing, but it was stopped at one when we looked up as the goal was scored. Right now, it shows nothing as the period apparently has come to an end. But the United States has tied the game.
A big, big goal for the U.S. team. Ken Morrow took a shot from the other side of center ice, or I'm sorry, it's Steve Christian, knowing that there was almost no time on the clock. But the rebound comes right out to Mark Johnson, who goes wide to Tretiak to tie it up. Very careless rebound, an uncharacteristically careless rebound by Tretiak. There you see it again as he sweeps wide and into the open side.
Now the United States, the players congregating around Kisla, the referee, and he is saying 1 second remains, yes. Because when we looked at the clock right after the goal, there was 1 second left, then it went down to zero, and Kisla holding up one finger. The Soviets, however, have gone back to their dressing room.
I believe what Kisla is saying now, that if there is 1 second, if there is only 1 second to go, which there is, then in fact, what has to happen is that the referee has to drop the puck because the period is still going.
All right, let's take a look again at the goal by Johnson with 1 second remaining.
Watch this.
As you can see, there's the goal with 1 second remaining in the first period. The Soviet Union, they had gone back to the dressing room, and Kisla is bringing them back out onto the ice. And they're bringing the goalie number one. Tretiak is already back in the dressing area. They've got Mushkin number one, the goaltender. The Soviets, with only Krutov now coming back on the ice along with Mikhailov.
Even though there's no chance at all that the U.S. team can score, it seems to me that the Soviet team should send out five players, if for nothing else than just their own self-respect. Looking out there on the ice and seeing only two players and a change in goal, it's a rather an unusual thing.
They thought that the period was over, but then Kisla said there was still 1 second remaining. And the Soviets now, as the puck is dropped for the faceoff, there's the horn. That is the official end of the first period after it had looked for a fleeting moment as if Kisla might not allow the goal. He does. With 1 second to play in the first period, as you look at Jim Craig skating off, it's the U.S. 2 and the Soviets 2.
You had to feel something, didn't you, watching that first period of those American kids? Remember, this is an American amateur hockey team. It was only selected last August 1st, started playing games together last September. They averaged 22 years of age. They are playing a team generally acknowledged to be the greatest hockey team in the world, bar none. The same team except for four players
who humbled an all-star team of the National Hockey League, remember, in the winter of 1979, beating them 6-0 in the third of three games. An unbelievable thing for those kids to hold the Soviets at a 2-2 score at the end of the first period. Now, we're going to be going back, of course, for the second and the third periods. Right now, we're going to take up another subject, men's slalom racing. Remember, this is the one where it looks like a forest of sticks that they're coming through. It was conducted over two runs. The favorite, as they went to Whiteface Mountain this morning, was Ingemar Stenmark, coming off his gold medal in the giant slalom earlier in the week. Let's pick it up now with Frank Gifford and Bob Beatty.
Frank Gifford along with Bob Beatty, and we've moved up the mountain here at Whiteface. Over my shoulder, the slalom course where the men's competition will be contested today. It'll be the women tomorrow, and of course, in the slalom, you have two runs, a combined time to determine the winner. And who better to tell us about the course and the favorites than the man who brought the United States their only men's Alpine Olympic medals going all the way back to 1964. Billy Kidd a silver, Jimmy Huga a bronze. Bob, the course.
Frank, you're making me feel old.
That was a long time ago, buddy.
Well, you know... You're right. You know, this course is an interesting one, and it's very steep, and it got quite icy last night because it got cold. I think we know that right now, standing out here. And also, we've seen downhill all week with a lot of speed. Then we've seen giant slalom with long, smooth turns. Now we're going to see a whole different look at alpine skiing, the slalom, with quick, little, active turns. The race is going to get very close to the gates. There's going to be a lot of room for error, and along with that, as is usual in a course, in a slalom event, a lot of falls, I'm sure. The favorite, well, he has to be Stenmark, but he's not the clear-cut favorite that he was in the giant slalom, as an example. Papangelov of Bulgaria, Bulgaria's never won a medal in men's alpine skiing, is very quick. In fact, a lot of people feel, including Stenmark himself, that he's just as quick as Stenmark is. Krizhai of Yugoslavia is also very good. But you know, I'm kind of keeping my fingers crossed for Phil Mayer of the United States, because he's also extremely strong in slalom.
And he's come up to this race in just exactly peak form. And here's Phil Mayer wearing bib number one. He'll leave the start house first in the first run. He's the United States' best hope for a medal. It's been a disappointing Olympics thus far for the men's team. For Phil, a 10th place in the giant slalom. But for Phil, it's been also a miraculous year of rehabilitation from that bone-shattering crash that occurred on this very mountain less than a year ago. The final forerunner crosses the finish line here at the slalom course. And you can see a tremendous crowd has moved up the mountain. It has been a long hike from the bottom of the baseline, and nevertheless, they are here. They are here to watch, of course, the famed Ingemar Stenmark, and of course, America's Phil Mayer, one of the favorites. And looking from behind the start house, this is the way the racer sees the course. There are over 60 gates, and the course is a little over 600 yards long. It's steep, it's icy, and Phil Mayer now has moved into the start house. Our best hope for a medal is on the course.
Well, Frank, you saw that look that Phil was actually looking at, and it is steep and it's icy. But you know, Phil is in a good position up here because he's starting number one. There won't be any chatter marks. There are 15 men in the draw, and Frank, and he was lucky to get the first draw.
Weaving through the gates, Phil Mayer. His best finish in the slalom this far this year was a fourth place in Long Beach, January 8th. And what a great comeback this racer has made since that shattering injury a year ago right on this very mountain in the giant slalom. They put screws in his ankle, a metal plate. As a matter of fact, he's skiing with four screws in there right at the moment.
Oh, and he got tangled up a little bit with that pole that got in his way. Those poles do pop out in front of you because you get so close to them in slalom. But he is having a good run, Frank.
That'll be the running time of the ride. Phil Mayer, the first racer on the course, driving for the finish line. He'll hit the electronic timing device, and Phil Mayer in first place, 53.31, and he'll watch as other racers come down the mountain. But what a profile and courage this young man has been for so many youngsters.
Frank, he threw a pretty good run at them. I think he's probably fairly satisfied. He had a little problems when he got tangled up with the poles, but otherwise he was pretty good.
And now, here is a young Austrian. He's just 18 years old, Christian Orlansky, but he has been rather spectacular thus far this season. Was third at Chamonix in the final slalom warm-up before the Olympics, and is really coming into his own.
Well, you know, he's very young. He's only 17, Frank. You know, in Austria, they just keep coming on and on and on, and he keeps feeling he's getting better and better. Now, he had a problem there, because that pole, similar to what happened to Phil Mayer, fell right in front of him. That could be a tremendous problem in slalom.
And you can hear from the chattering skis that it is very icy. It's very steep up on the top.
As you'll notice, as we see Orlansky come down here, Frank, he gets his back on every pole. You have to get close to the pole and cut down the radius of the turn.
Now, that is Phil Mayer's time up on the top, and he has beaten Mayer at the top by 0.1 seconds. Christian Orlansky, a little faster on the top than Phil Mayer.
He's a real talented slalom, and he is having a good run down here. Oh, he got trouble down there, Frank.
A lot of trouble. Christian Orlansky has disqualified.
What we can see as he comes down here, he's in good control. Sometimes a young fellow has a little trouble with his concentration. That's something you learn naturally with experience. But right there, he didn't get set up for the next turn. A little bit wide, and he had no way to get back for this one. Out of the race.
Christian Orlansky of Austria, meanwhile, up at the start house. Andreas Wintzau, perhaps the second or third best slalom skier in this competition. He is behind only Stenmark and Bojan Krija of Yugoslavia in World Cup points thus far this year.
Frank, this snow should be perfect for him because he's such a good skier technically. He concentrates well. He doesn't get his arms flailing around behind him and catch a lot of falls. Oh, and he had some trouble with his goggles. He took them right off. Took his hat right off there, Frank. Apparently his goggles sparked or something.
Andreas Dickens. Andreas Wintzau of Liechtenstein. Of course, he was the silver medalist earlier in the week in the giant slalom behind Stenmark.
Well, Frankie had trouble up there, but let's see how his midway time is.
Oh. Orlansky's time at the top of the hill on the left, and we'll get a chance to compare that run of Wintzau, but nevertheless, Orlansky disqualified. Phil Mayer is the leader. Here comes Wintzau.
Wintzau's having all kinds of trouble. The poles are getting in his way. He had goggles he had to lift off. He almost stopped completely. Oh.
Phil Mayer holds on to the lead. Andreas Wintzau in second place. Of course, Christian Orlansky disqualified, and Wintzau, I think he was mad. He does not show a lot of expression. He's not demonstrative at all. Nevertheless, he was really upset. And let's take a look at the problems that Wintzau had. And he had a bundle of them.
Well, I can understand his being a little bit upset, Frank, because he usually doesn't have problems of any kind, but particularly the kind that he had on the top of the mountain right here. Because this is something he couldn't do much about. It looks to me as though his goggles fogged up. Right here, you can see him reach up right in the middle of the turn and throw those goggles and the hat, of course, right over behind him. Major distraction, particularly with the gates coming up so fast in this slalom course.
So Andreas Wintzau of Liechtenstein has moved in second place behind Phil Mayer. Here's Phil Mayer. He's the leader. Still to come, of course, the great Ingemar Stenmark. He's the choice for the day. Bojan Krija of Yugoslavia, perhaps the second pick. Hans Inn of Austria. So for Phil, it'll be wait, watch, and hope. We'll be back at Whiteface in a moment.
Do you know me? I won a few gold medals in the 1968 Olympics as an amateur. But skiing for me now is a business. And for that, I need an American Express card. And for the receipts that they send back with the bill. Believe me, those records are easier to keep than speed records in the downhill.
To apply for a card, look for this display wherever the card is welcomed.
The American Express card. Don't leave home without it.
Introducing a steel-belted radio so new, even its footprint tells you it's different. Today, you need a tire that gives you fuel economy and all-season performance, wet, dry traction, and long tread life. Hydroplaning resistance and dry road stability. Arriva. So new, even its footprint tells you it's different. Only from Goodyear.
Goodyear, Arriva. Goodyear.
Another great racing name from the little principality of Liechtenstein, Paul Frommel, 22 years old, on the course.
Well, you have to wonder what he's thinking, having watched Wintzau have so much trouble on the course. He is outstanding in slalom. Two different temperaments. Wintzau, usually very calm, collected, and technically strong. He wasn't today. Frommel, though, usually comes down and starts flailing away. So far, only Phil Mayer has really had a good run down this course.
Frommel.
Oh, and he got some trouble. The pole was.
Oh, and he's off the course.
Frank, that's a very tough break because what happened to him up there was really not of his own doing. He flipped that pole out, and it got all caught up in front of him. As we can see him here, there's the pole on the ground, and his ski just goes right over it, slides on it, and he's out of the race. That's a tough break because those poles just flip out right in front of you. I've never seen that happen quite as much as it's been happening here in this slalom today.
A couple of key competitors out of this competition already. Frommel of Liechtenstein, he was one of the favorites. Christian Orlansky, the young Austrian, is out. The course is really taking its toll. But Phil Mayer's run looks even better. Two top racers gone from the competition. But Phil knows oh so well that some of the world's top racers are still to come, and they can take it away from him. But Phil will keep his eyes up at the top of the course. Now in the start house, another young racer, a 20-year-old Swiss, Jacques Luthi, and we saw him at Kitzbühel earlier in the season, Bob, and we know that he is a good slalom skier. Came from way back to finish high up there in Kitzbühel.
Oh, he's very good in slalom. And of the five slaloms leading in, the five World Cups leading to Lake Placid, he's been first in the first 10 in all five of them. He's known as being better probably in the second run. He's a good fighter and he's a good slalom skier.
Bill Mayer at the bottom of the hill looking up. He is the leader. Andreas Pinsel is in second place. He's seen two races already disqualified. Running time on the right of Luthi of Switzerland. It'll be compared against that of Orlansky up at the top.
This is a very tight course, too, Frank, as we see that midway turn.
Slightly faster than Orlansky at the top of the hill is Jacques Luthi, and he's really pouring it on, Bob.
Yes, he is. I started to say, Frank, this is a very tight course. By that, I mean that the gates are really set back and forth, and they're tough to get through. That's why we're seeing all those gates fall down.
Bill Mayer's on the time, and Mayer maintains the lead. And Jacques Luthi with a good run, and you get the feeling that Bill Mayer had a really fine run. He's getting those seas. He knows he's had a good run. Bill Mayer in first place. Luthi moved into second place. Vinsel in third place, and he'll watch. And again, keep in mind there are two runs in this competition, the combined time determining the winner. Up at the start house, another young Austrian, and a good one. He's been skiing for a long time, but Hans Inn is only 21 years old.
Well, he should be good on this course because it's steep and icy. Made to order for him, I think, in that he's small and quick. And these gates are set so that you have to be very quick or you get tangled up with them.
He's done well in giant slalom competition thus far this year with a third and a fourth in three giant slaloms, all of them behind Stenmark, who's yet to come.
He's actually a little better in giant slalom than he is in slalom. You can see those poles sliding around. That's a problem. They can, as we've said so many times, fall right in front of you.
That is Jacques Luthi, Swiss time. On the left, his best time thus far at the top of the hill. And Luthi's time holds up at the top of the hill. But Hans Inn has a fine run going.
And is going to be right in there, Frank. I don't think he's going to be ahead of Phil, though.
Down through the bottom gates, and Bill Mayer's time holds up again. Hans Inn has tied for second with Jacques Luthi. Bill Mayer is in first. Jacques Luthi, Hans Inn are tied for second, if you can believe that, when they calculate in 100s. Vinsel of Liechtenstein is in fourth place. And right now we're looking at, well, many feel that Bojan Krejci of Yugoslavia can take the gold. He's beaten Stenmark in a slalom race during the past season. Spectacular racer. He has the agility. He's 5'7", 150 pounds. He's really quick.
Well, right now, Frank, we're going to find out exactly how good Phil Mayer's time is, because Krejci is outstanding in slalom, particularly on steep, icy slopes like this one, because the one race he won this year in Vengen, Switzerland, was very steep, but it was also very hard.
Bojan Krejci from Yugoslavia. He's had a first, he's had a second, and he's had a fourth in five slaloms that have been run thus far this season.
Frankie, he just went the wrong way off the course and stuck. We're going to have to take a look at that to find out exactly what happened.
Bojan Krejci is out of the competition.
It looks to me like he just forgot which way he was going. I think he forgot the way the course was set. Frank, I don't think I've ever seen anything like this, maybe since, believe it or not, 1964, when the great Jean-Claude Keeley, as an 18-year-old in Innsbruck, did the same thing about five gates out of the finish. Right there, he seems, everything seems to be fine. He didn't make any mistakes. He's perfectly on his skis. Everything is okay now.
And what a stunning surprise.
Frank, he lost his way. There's a blue gate up here at the top of our screen. He just didn't go through it, and he lost the way down the mountain.
Incredible pressure on all the competitors here in the Olympics, and has taken his toll. And Bill Mayer has the lead by 39 one-hundredths of a second over Jacques Luthi of Switzerland and Hans Inn of Austria. They tied for second. Anton Steiner is in fourth place. And we'll be back as more of the world's best take their shot at Phil Mayer here in the first of two runs of the slalom.
You've come to the roof of the world where no man has skied before. Blazing a trail through virgin snow. Going for all the gusto you can get. And you go for it. In your life and in your beer. Schlitz, the one beer brewed with gusto since 1849. The official beer of the Winter Olympics. Go for it.
These lines determine how sharp your color TV picture will be. They're called lines of resolution. And the more lines, the sharper the picture. Magnavox has 25% more lines for a 25% sharper color picture than ever before. Magnavox, we make staying home fun.
Silver Anniversary Savings. Save up to $100 during the Magnavox 25th annual sale. On now.
Now we know where Phil Mayer is. He's in first place. As for my Monday night colleague, well, odds on the coach is cozied up in front of a fire someplace with Emmy doing just what you're doing, watching the Olympics. And this is Christian Neureuther of West Germany, 30 years old, the oldest man skiing alpine competition here in the Olympics.
He was almost out of the race right at the bump because a pole fell right in front of him, and he's already fallen down once, but he's still on the course. By the way, he's engaged to Rosie Mittermeier. So that's, I don't know if that helps you, Eddie.
Well, I like it. She's right up here watching.
But I think more important than that is at the age of 30, usually you don't have the quickness, the reflexes to be good in this slalom event. But Neureuther's very good.
And the best time up at the top of the hill. Jacques Lüdi and Neureuther well behind the time of Jacques Lüdi.
Well, he's had some trouble on the upper part of the course.
And he knows that. They have a running clock in their head, and he'll pound it down here below. Phil Mayer still the leader. He came down first, and he has not given up the lead. He will not give it up to Christian Neureuther. Moves into fourth place, does Neureuther. And already out of the competition, Christian Orlansky, Paul Promelt of Liechtenstein, and most important, Bojan Krizhai, who just got lost on the course. Phil Mayer's time looking better. And you saw him earlier kiss those skis. He knew he had made a great run, and he did. Out of the start house, the defending World Cup overall champion. He does not win a lot of races. As a matter of fact, he's only won one in his career, but he competes in all of the competitions. This is Peter Luscher of Switzerland.
Well, Luscher, of course, the overall World Cup champion, has not had a great year this year. He's actually even better in Giant Slalom, and he rocks right back off his skis right there.
Trouble.
And by so doing, he has straddled the
game. Luscher all over the place, out of the competition. Peter Luscher disqualifies, and Luscher is out. And the excitement continues to build. Still to come, Ingemar Stenmark. And for this man, the pressure had to be relieved somewhat when he collected the gold in the Giant Slalom on Tuesday. Let's get to know him better up close and personal.
As far as fame is concerned, Tarnaby is a one-man town. To be sure, it has its place in Swedish life as one of the few places suitable for alpine skiing, but its international reputation stems from the man on the bicycle. He's been painted as a sort of Hamlet of the hill. Well, like the Prince of Denmark, he is Scandinavian, and there are times when he has that same melancholy look, but the look may be deceiving. What appears to be melancholy in the case of Ingemar Stenmark is more likely intense concentration, a kind of mental toughness that's been a key ingredient in his three overall World Cup championships. At age 23, Stenmark has only one unrealized ambition, really. He has yet to win an Olympic gold medal. At home in the summer, he pursues his own training methods.
I think it's good if you forget about skiing in the summer and just do some running and so to keep you in good shape.
The unicycle is one of his special training tricks. It helps sharpen his marvelous sense of balance, and it's fun. But what is life like for a quiet man who's the number one tourist attraction of his town?
The people in this village, they never come to me and want to talk about skiing, but the tourists in the summer come and want photos. But at Christmas, it's very peaceful. Now, I think it would be difficult for me to go to a city. There are too many people in the city. I try to be alone and not to speak so much with the people around.
So perhaps there is a bit of Hamlet in him at that. To be sure, for a young unmarried world skiing champion, he does lead a quiet life at home. He likes to fish and think. This man who won 13 World Cup races in 1979, breaking a record set by the great Jean-Claude Killy. But is he a sullen, uncooperative loner, as some of the European ski press have pictured him? We didn't find him so. Rather, he seems cool, confident, concentrated. Here in Sweden, he has developed the poise that has enabled him to come from behind time after time to become not Hamlet, but the king of the hill.
Okay, hang on to your beanie because we're going to find out just how good Phil Mayer's time is. Ingemar Stenmark, we've already characterized him as the greatest technical skier in the world today, maybe in the history of alpine skiing. He's won 3 of 5 slaloms thus far this year. He's a gold medalist already here in the giant slalom.
Frank, this course was set by his coach, Svensson, so he probably has had a chance to train under similar type of course setting.
Phil Mayer, like us, looking up on the course. Bill Mayer has the lead. Jack Booty's in second place, tied with Hans in. Christian Neurotter is in third. But this is the man who could make the difference for Phil Mayer. We're in the first of 2 runs to determine the goal for the slalom. And that is still Jack Booty's best time on the top end. Ingemar Stenmark is fast.
Okay, Frank, we have a big story building here with Stenmark coming down and Phil Mayer sitting in first place right now. Stenmark has not been that great in slalom this year. He's won 2, but for him it hasn't been that great. Here he comes.
Mayer's time on the left, and it holds up as Phil Mayer watches him come to drop. He's 6/10 of a second back as Stenmark moves into fourth place. A great story building. Phil Mayer, who shattered that ankle out of his very mountain a year ago, has the lead. Many of the top racers already out of the competition. Stenmark has moved into fourth place. But, of course, there is another run to come. The goal determined by 2 runs of the slalom. Phil Mayer in first place. Jacques Gloutier, Hans in, tied. You can believe that again. In hundreds of a second, they calculate this race. And Stenmark has moved into fourth place.
Let's compare Chevy C10 pickup to its closest sales competitor. It doesn't top our miles per gallon. That's right, Chevy has unbeaten mileage. Chevy has a bigger payload weight. At a base price that's $43 less than the closest sales competitor. Unbeaten mileage, bigger payload, lower price. That's how much tough Chevy truck your money can buy. Chevy trucks, built to stay tough.
Annualized return, rates, earnings. In the maze of talk about high-yield savings plans, it's pretty easy to get lost. Who can help you find your way? The people at your credit union. They can sit down with you, show you the best savings plan for your situation, your family. Because the only shareholders they have to satisfy are their members, you. Your credit union, the best financial advisor your family has.
Tuesday, Laverne and Shirley get back together with Fonzie and the whole gang. Once again, they're back-to-back with Happy Days when Chachi finally puts his move on Jody. Then Laverne and Shirley take a blood-curdling ride on the Moose Jaw Express.
Tuesday on ABC.
An incredible thing has happened here. Bojan Krizhau, you saw him disqualify earlier. He looked puzzled. Apparently, a gate had been put back in the wrong place. He has been giving a rerun. It comes after the 18th racer has gone down the course. And, wow, I don't recall that happening.
Frank, this is a very tough break for Krizhai because there's no excuse, frankly, in the Olympic Games for poles to be put out of place.
Dave, there isn't. Obviously, there was. He's been given a rerun.
As we see them come down here now, there have been a lot of poles banged out. So they are all off the ground. What happened is the gatekeeper just got up and put the pole in the wrong spot. Obviously, when we saw Krizhai come down, it looked to him like he was puzzled. He didn't even know where the course was.
And now he's running on a course that has been rutted thoroughly by an additional 8-9 racers who have come down the course. He originally was in 8th place, as you can see from the number on his back, in the top seat of 15. And now he is running on a very rough course.
And I don't think his intermediate time is going to be all that great, because in addition to himself going twice, he's...
Oh, it is! Anymore, but he's look what he's done! Bojan Krizhai of Yugoslavia. He's been sensational in World Cup slalom competition this season. He has won one race, and he is the only man on the course now that's going to catch Bill Mayer, who has the lead. Bill Mayer on the left.
He's going to be very close.
He's going to be close to Mayer. He does not do it. Mayer holds on to the lead. Grigio moves into fourth place, and that moves Thingamar back one notch. So it's Bill Mayer. He has the lead. Jacques Lutie and Hans Inner tied for second. And then it's Bojan Krejci with a tremendous gallant performance, and Ingemar Stenmark.
Good one. You're sitting in a good spot. That snow isn't all that bad at the beginning.
I wanted to run the top, you know, six or so today in my first run, because I think the snow gets chattery after, you know, about that many, and it's hard to get off the edge then. And actually, I think I had an ideal number for the first run. It was really good.
In your wildest imagination, last match, you think you'd be standing here right now?
I never had any doubts. Everybody else did, but I never did.
There are a couple of us that didn't either, frankly. Good luck to you in the second round.
Thank you, Bob.
Everybody else sure did have some doubts about whether Phil Mayer would be here on this day. It was only 355 days ago that he shattered his ankle up there on Whiteface. As we said, the enthusiasm, the anticipation has been tremendous here all day, and you must be beginning to get an idea of what kind of a day it has been from watching the first period of the hockey game and the first run of the slalom. Remember, the second run of the slalom takes place on the same day. We're going to return to the hockey game, to the second period, but before we do, let's meet one of those young Americans, 22-year-old Mark Johnson from Madison, Wisconsin, the same hometown, that's right, as Eric Heiden. In fact, as you'll find out, they know each other quite well. Here we go.
An interesting story here at the Winter Olympics concerns the families and friends of the United States hockey team. That large group has moved into this one house in Lake Placid. Over 40 people are living here, including two women very special to U.S. forward Mark Johnson, his girlfriend Leslie Shore, and his mother Martha. Unfortunately, however, because of his current duties, Mark's father Bob, who coached the 1976 U.S. Olympic hockey team and is now head coach at Wisconsin, isn't here to see his son fulfill a dream they've shared for years.
It's been very difficult because there's not a telephone around here, and he is coaching right now this weekend, and so he was watching ABC, and he had his dinner in his room in the Duluth, or in the Normandy Hotel in Duluth, and oh, he's really excited. It's a difficult situation, I guess I'd have to say. I said it kind of tears my heart that he can't be here to enjoy it, because he loves to watch him play, but you can't wear two hats, so.
Well, you know Bob Johnson was proud of his son as he watched last Thursday's action, because Mark scored what turned out to be the winning goal against Czechoslovakia. Mark was the college player of the year in 1979, and when you're that talented but weigh only 155 pounds, opponents try to intimidate you. Here in the third period against the Czechs, Mark was flattened by Czech defenseman Jan Neliba, resulting in a bruised shoulder. But Mark is well aware of the dangers inherent in top-level hockey competition.
For someone of my size, the injury, you know, chance of injury becomes greater because the size of the players and the ability of the players as you go up the level. I think any time you get a slight injury, you get involved in a game, and you just, you know, you got to use your mind, because mind plays a major role in any type of athletics, and if you can block things out, you know, it's just after the game that they tend to hurt, but, you know, I've blocked most of them out.
That's exactly what he did in the game against Norway Saturday, as he again scored what turned out to be the winning goal. And nobody was more excited than his girlfriend since his high school days, Leslie Shore.
Just seeing somebody that you know who's in the Olympics itself, you're so proud to say that that's somebody, you know, who's so close to you. It's just chilling, you know.
The Olympics, I think, for any amateur athlete, you know, is the greatest thrill in their lives. You know, it brings all the amateur athletes in the world together. It brings the media, the press. It just brings everybody together as it seems like a one unit. And the thrill to just be around, to meet people from different countries, and just be surrounded by so many different styles of life, just I think is one of the greatest thrills any athlete can achieve.
One of the people Mark has become reacquainted with during the Olympics is an old friend from his hometown of Madison, Wisconsin, Eric Heiden. They used to be teammates on a Pee Wee hockey team there, and if the United States hockey team continues to confound the experts, Eric Heiden may not be the only young man from Madison to bring home an Olympic gold medal.
Two kids who played Pee Wee hockey together, providing quite a 1-2 punch for the United States Olympic team. Mark Johnson, the young man who scored that goal with 1 second to go in the first period to tie the Soviets at 2-2, a remarkable result of that first period. We'll be going right back to the game after this break.
As we strike the second period now, a change for the Soviet Union as Vladimir Mushkin becomes the new goalie after Tretiak had given up two in the first period.
Tretiak had a very shaky first period. Mushkin has a little bit of international experience. There's Tretiak on the bench, a very uncharacteristic place for him. Mushkin played well last year in the final game of the Challenge Cup Series, shutting out the NHL All-Stars 6-0. But since that time, in games against North American teams, in particular NHL games, he's done very poorly this year. And so it was a very courageous decision, really, by Coach Viktor Tikhonov. And it's really a reflection on the problems that Tretiak has been having.
As the second period begins, the Johnson line out for the United States. Johnson scoring the goal with just 1 second remaining in the first period to tie the game 2-2. The U.S. 2, the Soviet Union 2. Jim Craig in the nets for the United States. Morrow getting it loose along the boards. The U.S. in white, the Soviets in red. Kasatkinov tied up, and we've got a whistle. In the first period, Vladimir Krutov scoring for the Soviet Union at 9-12 to make it 1-0. Bud Schneider tied the game at 14-03. Then Makarov scored for the Soviet Union at 17-34 to make it 2-1. And then the last second goal by Mark Johnson at 19-59 to tie it 2-2.
Perhaps the Tretiak is playing in a very different role, actually, these days. Early on, he was the guy who was really responsible for winning games for the Soviet team when they came to North America. Now his role is more to prevent them from losing games, and it's a much different role and a much more difficult role.
Tretiak, only 27 years old. Mushkin in the nets for the Soviet Union. At the moment, here in the second period, 24. Harlamov, number 17, the veteran. And Harlamov has to bring it back because the Soviets would have been offside had he crossed the blue line. Now up ahead to Petrov. Petrov in on the left side, number 16. And a whistle and a penalty coming up against the United States. The first penalty against the Americans as referee Carl Gustav Keisler of Finland sending number 28, Harrington, as you take a look at the replay, to the penalty box.
Here's a very big test for the U.S. team. The Soviet team has had a lot of trouble with their power play in the Super Series against NHL teams over Christmas and also so far in these Olympics. And I have to assume that it's because they play a very predictable pattern on defense. They try to get the focus of the game on one part of the ice, slip somebody else into the opening, but it's not that surprising anymore. And teams are defending against it very well, and they're unable to outnumber their opponents any better than 5-4. They like to get it down to 2-1 or 3-2.
This is their first power play of the game. Craig got a piece of it. Back it comes back to the point. This is Vilya Letunov, number 14. Pervukin. Golikov now out in front of Vilya Letunov. The shot is high. Alexander Golikov, number 23. His brother is number 25, Vladimir. Vilya Letunov again. It's blocked out in front by McClanahan. He clears the zone. A minute 30 remaining in the penalty to Harrington, who went off on the holding call. Now Golikov. Makarov leaving it for Alexander Golikov. And he's picked up at the blue line, and back comes Johnson for the U.S. Mark in over the blue line. And Johnson passing it along the boards, killing some more time. McClanahan ties it up there. And the Americans have eaten away 51 seconds of the penalty to Harrington. A minute 9 left in Harrington's penalty. 18-11 to go in the second period.
You can continue to kill a penalty the way the U.S. team is doing, and that is to keep it outside of your own defensive zone. You should have much more success against the Soviet power play. They pass the puck around well. They rarely will give it up or attempt or possibly lose possession because they only take the good shot. But if you can keep it down in the Soviet zone, you can waste an awful lot of time.
The Americans trying to waste time here as Broughton trying to pin it, but the Soviets able to move it up to center ice. Taken away there by Dave Christian. 50 seconds remaining now in the penalty to Harrington. Baker in control. Baker losing it. Krutov. up ahead to Maltsev. Maltsev on a breakaway. Maltsev gets it by Craig to give the Soviets the lead. So the Americans with a chance to control the center ice. And then Krutov able to get it over to Maltsev in on the breakaway. And the Soviets move back on top 3-2.
There's a puck goes to Maltsev, and he's got up ahead of steam. And Christian cannot catch up to him. Sweeps wide around Craig. Here we see it again. We see Maltsev sweeping around. Christian was having to skate backwards and couldn't keep up with Maltsev.
So the Soviets again have the lead to score. The Soviet Union 3, the United States 2.
Would you believe the real story behind the Amityville Horror?
That's incredible.
Baker, come along. I was... Newton, right. You are the most organized fellow I've ever met.
Thank you, sir.
But you're always writing letters when you could get a lot more done on long distance.
Yeah, but I have to write things down before I feel organized.
Why not make notes for yourself in advance and follow them when you're on the phone? That way you have the organization of a letter plus the efficiency of long distance, hey?
Huh? Terrific idea. I'll make a note of that.
Long distance. It's the way to get things done today.
For over 23 years, Leif Johnson Ford has been Austin's leading automobile dealer. We've accomplished this by offering the best prices on sporty, economical cars, the best prices on dependable Ford trucks, and the best prices on luxurious full-size cars, all backed by the service people expect from the leader. Today we are Austin's leading automobile dealer, but then we've never been anything less. Leif Johnson Ford. Still the leader.
Cary Grant into Catch a Thief at 11 on 24.
10 minutes and 45 seconds remaining. We're in the second period. The Soviet Union leading the United States 3-2. Wells on the faceoff for the U.S. Ramsey losing it, but it's picked up by Rakota at his own blue line. Now the Soviets at center ice. Vasiliev to Harlamov. Into the corner now Petrov, strapping for it with Wells. That's Strobel, number 19. And Morrow. To try to come out of his own end now. Number 3, Kenny, out of Bowling Green. Up ahead, it's kept in by Harlamov. Craig coming out of the net. Craig now will try to pin it against the boards. The puck is still loose, and now finally Craig is able to cover up. Oh, it could have been a dangerous play as Petrov gets into it with Ramsey. Ramsey dropping his stick. So Petrov and Ramsey broken apart.
Periodically, we make comment about how international rules differ from NHL rules. You saw an instance there where Jim Craig fell on the puck behind the goal line. If that happened in the National Hockey League, and if he was unpressured as he was there, or was unpressured directly, it would have been a penalty for delay of game. In this particular instance, international hockey, there's no penalty.
10 minutes and 10 seconds remaining, and now Kiesler. The official from Finland apparently has given a penalty to the United States. The door of the penalty box is open. The clock says 2 minutes.
Yes, Jim Craig and I didn't know the rule. It appears as if he's getting a penalty for delaying the game.
That is the case with Craig. And the penalty will be served by number 19, Eric Strobel. So again, the Soviets with a power play opportunity.
Had he been directly pressured, had a Soviet player been pushing with him, fighting for the puck and so on, that would not have been a penalty. But as it was, he just fell on the puck behind the goal line.
So the Soviets with another power play opportunity. Their veteran line, Harlamov, Petrov out there. But Johnson at center ice. Johnson in over the blue line. Johnson to Schneider, but Buzz couldn't get good wood on the puck. And the shot goes wide as the Soviets come quickly back the other way with Harlamov, number 17, in over the blue line. Harlamov skating around Ramsey. Back to the net. Harlamov looking to center. Comes out in front to Fedosov. His shot is knocked down by Johnson. And Mark able to clear the zone again. Johnson over on the left side to Schneider. Taken away by Petrov. Mikhailov now to Harlamov. Harlamov centering to Petrov out in front. His shot was blocked in front. Kasatinov to Harlamov again. Harlamov centering pass. Fedosov couldn't get his stick on it. Keeping it in. Out in front to Harlamov. And then shot in. It's wide by Harlamov as he goes over to get it in the corner to Kasatinov. Number 7. Kasatinov out in front. Schneider knocking it down in front, and Johnson back for the Americans. Johnson trying to clear the zone and does by passing it down the ice with 9:02 remaining in the period and 50 seconds left in the penalty.
U.S. team was very fortunate there. They were running around in their own defensive zone, particularly defenseman Mike Ramsey, who has been going out to the point, going into the corner much too much. He's got to maintain his position in front of the net.
Davey Christian now. Christian clearing it down the ice. That'll lead up a few more seconds. And Broughton sweeping in. Back of the net. Broughton keeping it in with 25 seconds remaining in the penalty to Eric Strobel. Golikov. Back the other way for the Soviets. Up ahead to Makarov. Gasatnov at the point. Off the skate of Christian. Baker trying to pin it, and does, with only 7 seconds now remaining in the penalty. So effectively thus far, the Americans have killed 153 of the two-minute penalty to Craig, which is being served by Strobel.
Here we have the play previously with Mark Johnson finding Buzz Schneider, but his shot just goes wide. The U.S. team has got to capitalize on their opportunities. They've had very few, but they've had two good ones this period with the breakaway by Harrington and that particular two-on-one. The Soviets will not give you that many chances. The ones that you get, you're going to have to score on.
The Americans now with Johnson, McClanahan, Baker, and Christian as they try to eat up the remaining 7 seconds of the penalty. Key faceoff here, controlled by the U.S. Baker, back of his own net, then losing the puck. Starikov, his shot was wide. Strobel has come out of the penalty box. The teams now are at equal strength. Golikov keeping it in at the point. Makarov getting tied up. Davey Christian now, number 23, clearing it down the ice. And we'll have an icing call here as Vasiliev goes back to make the touch. So 7:47 remaining in the second period. It's still the Soviet Union 3 and the United States 2.
You're looking at a superbly engineered instrument, a Gillette Atra razor. Because no two faces are the same, the head pivots, allowing Atra micro-smooth twin blades to adjust to the contours of your face for a really close, safe shave. If all this sounds like we're trying to get you to buy an Atra, you're wrong. We just want you to buy 5 blades, and we'll give you this Atra razor free. But hurry, an offer like this goes fast. Buy 5 blades, get a free Atra razor.
What do you do before dinner?
I start a fire.
We cook together.
Nothing.
Now, what do you do before dinner that isn't better with a glass of Colony wine?
Start a fire.
We cook.
Nothing. Nothing at all.
What are you doing before dinner that wouldn't be better with the...
Soviets moving in over the blue line. And Kristoff able to take Krutov out of the play. Steve, number 11. Lebedev takes the puck away. Krutov, number 9. Out in front to Kasatinov. Slap shot. Saved by Craig. Save off the rebound. And a whistle. And now Ramsey starts to get in it again, this time with Lebedev. Number 11 is Craig is down. So here's Craig, after making the save, is shaken up.
Well, as he was bowled over, it appears as if he may have fallen back into the goalpost. He's got only a very little bit of protection on the back of his head.
The crowd responding now because of the penalty call, but it's going to be coincidental. Not only will a Soviet player go off, but also an American. As they send Morrow to the penalty box.
Here's the play, and a tough save by Craig. A slight screen, and here's Krutov. Krutov is going after the rebound, and finally he's piled over by Morrow. Krutov is very much of a second-generation Soviet forward. Earlier on, perhaps the prototype was somebody like Karlamov, who is small and quick. Krutov is about the same height as Karlamov, but he's much stronger, much wider, much more involved in a robust game, giving up very little in the sense of quickness.
We have coincidental penalties. Morrow is going off for cross-checking 2 minutes, and Lebedev And the call on Lebedev, unsportsmanlike conduct for 2 minutes. Johnson on the faceoff against Petrov. Petrov gets tied up, and it's Rob McClanahan, number 24. To Christian. Kept in by the Soviets. Petrov, his shot. And Craig able to get an arm on it. Starikov. In the corner now, McClanahan for the U.S. 2.5 minutes to go in the second period. The Soviets on top, 3-2, as Petrov comes in over the blue line. Ridden out by Baker, but kept in by Starikov. Now Johnson back to get it for the U.S. Mark, who scored a goal with 1 second to play in the first period, losing it. Mikhailov, number 13, the captain. Vasiliev out in front, taken off his stick by Johnson with McClanahan now. McClanahan skating it over the blue line. McClanahan comes back out to the point to Baker. Bill, his shot blocked in front by Starikov. 1:50 remaining in the second period and 55 seconds in the coincidental penalties as the team skate five aside. Mikhailov taken out at the blue line, but Balderas is there to pick it up. However, lost to Pavlich. Pavlich skating in. Taken away from him, and back out it comes to O'Callaghan. O'Callaghan out in front as Starikov got a skate on it and passing up ahead to Balderas. Ramsey clearing it back to center ice. 1:22 to play in the second period. 28 seconds left in the coincidental penalties. Pavlich takes it at the blue line. Leaves it for Schneider. Schneider sweeping in. His shot was wide. O'Callaghan keeping it in. Around the boards to Schneider, who's checked by Pervukin. Balderas tries to clear and does. Now Makarov skating in on right wing. Makarov tied up by Pavlich. And Vasiliev couldn't get much on the shot as the Americans start back the other way with 55 seconds to play in the second period. Ramsey to Kristoff. And Lebedev to the Soviets, clearing it back to center ice. 40 seconds to play now in the second period.
Both teams changing fairly rapidly here with just a short time to go, but here's a break by Krutov.
He lost. Krutov tried to get it over to Lebedev out in front and couldn't, but Krutov is there again. Comes back out to Vasiliev near the point. Now to Pervukin. Pervukin's slap shot is covered up by Jim Craig.
Every time Krutov is on the ice, something happens. He's only 19 years old, but he's an excellent player, and he's really been the game breaker in most of the important games that the Soviets have played. Here's the pass over to Vasiliev. He doesn't get too much on it, and right into Craig's chest.
Krutov in the tournament as far as you look at Pervukin. His team 4-0-1 in the preliminary round. Krutov with 4 goals thus far in the tournament. The Soviets' leading scorer would be Alexander Golikov, number 23, who has 7 goals in the 5 games. 12 seconds remaining now in the period. Broughton getting tied up with Kasatkinov. Baker keeps it in. 3 seconds now remaining in the period. And the second period is over. So the only scoring in the second period came early on a power play at 2:18. Alexander Malkin scoring off a pass from Krutov. And that's the difference in the game right now. After the second period at the Olympic Ice Center, it's still the Soviet Union 3 and the United States 2.
Okay, the Soviet Union led the United States by a score of 3-2. In a game being played right now, in the middle of the second period, Sweden trails Finland by 2-1. Now, there are a lot of possibilities in that hockey tournament. If the Soviet Union ends up to be the winner of the game that you're watching and will be watching the third period of, if they win their other game on Sunday, they would win the gold medal. Should Finland win that game tonight in which they're leading, should the United States turn out to be the winner of the game with the Soviet Union, the United States could win the gold medal by beating Finland on Sunday morning. As I said, we're not going to tell you who won that hockey game because some of you still may not know, and we're not going to spoil it for you. Men's slalom. This was this morning up on Whiteface Mountain. After the first run, most surprisingly, Phil Mayer of the United States was the leader. The second run, however, was yet to come. Let's go to that now with Frank Gifford and Bob Beatty.
We're moments away from the second run of the men's slalom here in Whiteface Mountain. As you can see, the weather has changed remarkably. The snow is coming down, but that has not affected one of the great stories that has developed here in the Olympic Games. Phil Mayer, has come down the mountain in the first run. He is in first place. Phil Mayer with the best World Cup finish thus far of the season, along Greece, Germany, in January, a fourth place. But he has taken over first place. And if you consider the position in alpine skiing, men's alpine skiing in the world, this story rivals that of the U.S. hockey team and rivals the feat of Eric Heiden, because Phil Mayer is in first place after the run. That is truly remarkable. Remarkable in the sense that it was a little less than a year ago that Phil Mayer on this very mountain in the giant slalom, first run, fell, shattered his ankle. It was put back together with seven screws, a metal plate. Many said he would never ski again. He has skied again. He's in first place. He has a great shot at a gold medal in the slalom competition. The U.S. Alpine men's team has only collected two medals in the history of alpine skiing in the Olympics. They did it in 1964 with Billy Kidd and Jimmy Huga. Bob Beatty was the coach of that Olympic team in 1964, and Bob, there was also a bit of a controversy that developed in that first run. Bojan Krizhai, one of the fine international skiers from Yugoslavia, well, he was confused by a gate. He was given a second run. You've been pursuing that story of the results.
Well, Frank, he came down the mountain, and all of a sudden, he just stopped. And there was some speculation as to whether or not he had really missed a gate, or whether it had been misplaced, or whether it had been knocked down by a previous racer. So the jury came down. They went to our tape trucks. They took the tape of the race out, and they had a chance to compare it with other racers who had also come down. And they finally made the decision that, yes, Krizhai was disqualified. You know, it's kind of a tough break for Krizhai. He's an outstanding slalom racer. He's probably, next to Stenmark, been the best this year so far. You know, the Olympics is a tough place to get confused.
Indeed it is, and of course it is a great story. Once again, as we explained to you, in slalom competition, in the second run, they reverse the order of the top five finishers. And with Krizhai out, that means that Christian Neureuter will come down the mountain first. He is 1 6/100ths of a second behind the lead of Phil Mayer. Then we will see Stenmark come down. He is 58 hundredths of a second back. And of course, Hans Inn of Austria and Jacques Luthi of Switzerland, they were tied for second. They're 39 hundredths of a second behind Phil Mayer. Here's Phil Mayer right now. Bobby's minutes away from the greatest race of his life. He can only speculate what might be going on in his mind.
Well, you know, Frank, that he's thinking a little bit, I'm sure, that he has the chance to do what no American male has ever done, and that is to win an alpine gold medal. And I think that that's got to be there. But on the other hand, what he's really trying to do is block all of that out and concentrate on the placement of the gates. He doesn't want to have happen to him what happened to Krizhai, where he actually forgets where the gates are placed. And, you know, I think that when you think about what he's overcome to get to where he is right now, that tells you something about Phil Mayer.
And over the past year, we've learned a lot about this young man who has come back against incredible odds. You know, the pain is still often there, but when he spoke with Bob earlier, there was not the slightest complaint.
Phil, the ankle, how is it?
It's really been good. In the last two or three months, I've had, you know, one or two days here and there that's bothered me. But in general, it's really good.
Phil, when you're skiing, do you think of the plate and the four screws that are in your ankle?
No, not really. I don't notice them too much at all. I think sometimes it gets a little tender running against the front of the boot because the tendons and stuff run over the screws and that. But I don't really notice it too much. Maybe during weather changes or something sometimes.
Phil, you've been injured many times before. You've had to come back from all kinds of accidents, and you've really done that quite well. Does the fact that you've had to come back from an accident, or several of them, help you?
I think it helps quite a bit. It makes you all the more hungry. You just, you know, you feel like you've had something taken away from you, and you want to come back and work all the harder and gain back what you've lost.
This winter, it seems to me as though, although you've had some pretty good results, you've had some excellent first runs and also some excellent second runs, but you seem to be having some trouble putting two runs together. Why?
It's really been a troublesome factor this year, my consistency. I'll have one, you know, outstanding run, and then I'll either have a big mistake in one run or just won't ski good for a couple, you know, for half the course or something. But that's the main thing. I just got to get more concentrated, I think, and put, you know, two runs together back-to-back, and then I can win races.
After the many injuries you've had in ski racing, the tremendous number of comebacks you've had, particularly the last injury, I think, probably being the most severe, what would it mean to you to win a medal here in Lake Placid?
It would mean an awful lot. It'd mean basically the same thing as winning a World Cup. You really proved to yourself and really to the world that you're the best on that one given day. And you compete with the best in the world, and if you win, it's really an emotional feeling.
While we have a moment, let's go back and take a look at the controversy that was centered around the young Yugoslavian skier, Bojan Križaj of Yugoslavia.
Well, Frank, we could see him coming down here. He's a very good technical skier, extremely precise. He's hitting every turn very well right through here. Nothing very complicated about the setting of the gates to this point. They alternate red and blue. And now as he comes down, we're going to see where he gets into the problems. Around the red, okay, around the blue, but right here, after this red close gate, he turns too quick, and he misses the gate over here on the left. And that's where he should have gone, Frank, and right now, he knows something has gone astray, because he stops right here and looks back at that blue gate that he just missed.
Any reason, Bob, you feel for that confusion?
Well, you know, the gates do come very fast at you. The course is extremely steep. There's no real reason, though, Frank. It's just one of those lack of concentration things that happen to you in sports. It just shouldn't happen during the Olympics.
And the second and exciting run is still to come. Phil Mayer in first place. Hans in of Austria. Jacques Lutie of Switzerland. They are 39 one-hundredths of a second back. Ingemar Stenmark is 58 one-hundredths of a second back. And Christian Neurutter is in fifth place.
Even in a changing world, some things will never change, like the comfort of 100% cotton denim jeans. 100% cotton means soft, breathable comfort. And Wrangler makes them with a special no-fault process. They won't shrink, pucker, or wrinkle. They fit natural, fade natural, and stay neat, no matter where you take them. When you're looking at blue jeans, check the label. Make sure you're looking at 100% cotton denim.
Call this sailing, but you're flying across the ice at over 70 miles an hour, balanced on a razor's edge, and you go for it. You go for all the gusto you can get, making the most of now, from the life you live to the beer you drink, Schlitz. The one beer brewed with gusto since 1849, the official beer of the Winter Olympics. Go for it.
All right, and you have an electric feeling here at Whiteface Mountain at the moment. Phil Mayer, of course, in first place. That means they'll reverse the order. He'll come down in fifth. But Americans have lined this entire course, and it just seems almost impossible, I think, to so many of them that we have only won two medals in men's alpine skiing in the history of the Olympic Games. Those were a silver medal by Billy Kidd in 64. Jimmy Huga got a bronze that same year in 1964. And it's just an incredible feeling that has swept over this group. There's Christian Neurutter, he'll come first, and Stenmark, Jacques Luthie, a great young Swiss racer, and then Hans in of Austria, and then will come Phil Mayer. And realistically, Bob, who has a shot at it?
Well, realistically, Frank, Stenmark always has a shot, and he's only sitting in there 58 one-hundredths of a second behind, and also Luthie and then 39 one-hundredths of a second behind have a shot at it. Those are the guys that Phil's going to have to worry about most. Mostly, Phil's going to have to worry about Phil and make sure he has a good run down the mountain.
Snow still falling. Visibility, any problem, Bob?
Well, it was snowing a little bit harder just a few minutes ago. It's kind of eased up a little bit now. Frankly, I don't think that is a problem.
Ready now for the second run. Christian Neurutter, he is the man we told you, is the oldest man skiing in alpine competition, a West German, 30 years old, his third Olympics. He was fifth at Innsbruck in the slalom. He was 11th at Sapporo. He put on a tremendous run, finishing in fifth place after the disqualification of Bojan Križaj, and Neurutter's on the course.
Frank, that disqualification of Križaj was a real break for Neurutter, because now he's starting first as a reverse of the field. Otherwise, he would have been sixth, and he would have been starting in sixth position. Also, Frank, he has what we call in slalom a stand-up technique. He doesn't get too low on his skis. A lot of people feel that this mountain is made to order for him because it's very steep. He doesn't have to generate speed. He just has to ski technically well, which he does.
We saw him finish third at Chamonix in the World Cup in the final tune-up for the Olympics. He was second at Kitzbühel, and it's really been a comeback for this veteran racer that divides his time between ski racing and medical studies.
He's got to attack a little bit more, I think, Frank, if he's going to be up there with the leaders, because he's just kind of skiing the hill. Again, that's what he likes to do. He doesn't generate a lot of speed, so if the mountain is steep enough, it'll generate it for him.
And that is the time of Christian Neurutter, 50.77, his combined time, 145.14. Of course, taking the lead as the first racer down the course. It could have been he was being cautious because of all the disqualifications we saw in the first run. This is a different course. There are fewer gates, 60 gates. There were over 60 gates on the first course. And let's go up to the start house. Ingemar Stenmark And it's hard to say what goes through the mind of this great ski racer, recognized as the greatest technical racer perhaps of all time on the course. He was, of course, in fourth place after the first run.
Well, Frank, here's a racer who's not going to be cautious at all, I suspect. He's always been good in second runs, not only in Giant Slalom, which we've already seen in this Olympics, but in Slalom, too. If he's had a problem in the last few years in Slalom, is he jumps a little bit. His quickness maybe is leaving him as he gets old at the age of 23. He's worried about that. Watch to see if the skis stay on the ground or if they come up and then hit a little bit hard. It's a little harder.
Running time. I think my stand mark on the right. We'll compare that against Christian Neurutter of West Germany on the left. That, of course, at the top of the hill. And Stenmark has better the time than Neurutter at the top of the hill. He's been skiing well in World Cup this season, Bob. He's won two of five events.
Well, he's got about a tenth of a second lead over Neurutter. On the other hand, he was 58 hundredths of a second behind Phil Mayer.
And we have a new leader. Ingemar Stenmark has the new leader. Ingemar Stenmark, who fell in the second run of the slalom as a heavy favorite at Innsbruck, losing out to Piero Grove. He has not fallen. He is the leader at the moment.
He was good on the bottom part of that course, too, Frank. Something that we're going to have to consider when Mayer comes down.
23-year-old Swede, who's already taken the gold medal in the giant slalom. He would love to make it a double. He'll have to wait, look up the hill, because there is a young Swiss racer at the top of the hill moving into the start house. He's 20 years old. We've seen him do some pretty amazing things already this season, Bob. He
yes,
comes
Frank,
from way
yeah.
back. Jacques Luthi on the course.
When you mention how amazing he is, it's because he skis so well in the second run. He's a real fighter, and he's a youngster, and he's consistent, which is also unusual for a young racer. He hasn't fallen in a slalom race this year. Look at him attack this course. He really is fighting hard, Frank.
Luthi, along with Hans Inn, tied for second behind Phil Mayer. They were 39 hundredths of a second back of Phil Mayer. Jacques Luthi is really attacking, and we'll get a chance to compare his intermediate time at the top against the leader, Ingemar Stenmark, who is watching.
Get a little trouble there.
That's Stenmark's time on the left. That for the top of the hill. Here's Luthi. No, he does not do as well as Stenmark on the top. He'll have to push down here.
It was pretty good. Then all of a sudden, he got a little bit wide and got jammed up in a gate. Actually, Frank, this second course runs a lot easier and a little bit more of a flow than the first one did. We don't see the poles flying all over the place.
Luthi's time of the ride, and no. So it's Stenmark. And Luthi is in third place behind Neurutter. And now Stenmark has an idea of how well he did on that hill. They know pretty much how they have done, but he now can compare it against racers. Luthi, brother, has moved into second place. Neurutter in third place. And here's a youngster, Hans N. of Austria. He can be spectacular. He's at a third and a fourth this year, three giant slalom. And he is also a tremendous slalom skier.
Well, Frank, we just saw Luthi come down, and we said that he really attacks those second runs. The problem that N. has had as a slalom racer is he frequently backs off during the second run. He has a good first run. Then he doesn't go so fast, but he does look like he's attacking pretty well right in here. He's very small, and he's extremely quick. It does help him on a steep hill like this, and particularly when it's icy. He can get off those edges fast.
Now the running time of Hans Inn of Austria on the right. Again, the time on the left is Denmark's time at the intermediate point. His time for the top of the hill.
He's having a really good time. Oh, as a matter of fact, he's about 8 9 tenths of a second behind.
And that'll give us an idea of just how good that run was, the second run of Stenmark.
Keep in mind that second run of Stenmark was really good on the bottom part.
He'll never catch Denmark as Hans Inn trips the electrical timing device. He moves into third place. Stenmark, Luthi, and Hans Inn. Neurutter and the leader looking up the hill, because up on the top of the hill will be America's Phil Mayer, the leader by 39 hundredths of a second after the first run. Oh, and you can just feel it. You have to wonder what's in the mind of this youngster. He's cool. He almost ended his career in this mountain a little less than a year ago, and here he goes for the gold medal, Bob.
Frank, of overcoming obstacles builds character. This racer has to have more character than anybody in the world. But right now, he's got to overcome somebody. He has problems right here at the top with a pole that came right in front of him. Fortunately, it didn't really make him fall down or get out of his way too much.
His best finish coming into the Olympics, the fourth place in World Cup competition. That's back in January. He doesn't talk about it, but he skis at times when his ankle is aching, the pain is severe. Stenmark's time at the top of the hill at the left. The running time of Mayer on the right. How will he do? Not good. He's slow on the top. He'll have to hit it on the bottom.
Frank, yeah. He was a little sluggish on the top part of the course. He's a little stiff up there. He's going to have to really stop popping those turns down here at the bottom. He's going to have to get a little more attacking to see.
Running time on the right. He had a 3,900th of a second lead coming in. No.
No, he did win a gold, but he's in second place.
He's in second place. Ingemar Stenmark is in first place. Then Phil Mayer and Jacques Luthi. And Stenmark has already assumed that he has won the gold medal. And for Phil Mayer, he gave it his best shot, had a little bit of a problem up on the top of the hill, and he has moved into second place.
Silver medal and being behind Stenmark and what he's had to overcome, I think that's great.
And let's give credit to Ingemar Stenmark, the heavy favorite at Innsbruck in Austria in 64. He fell in the second run. Pierre Gros took the gold, and you saw Phil Mayer shaking the hand of the great Ingemar Stenmark. And there'll be other confrontations, you know that. There is a picture.
Ingemar Stenmark with the gold medal, Phil Mayer with the silver. And we'll be back with the final results, and Bob will have a word with Ingemar Stenmark and Phil Mayer. Stenmark, who has now taken his second gold medal. Just Ingemar Stenmark takes the gold, coming from behind in the second run. Phil Mayer collects the silver, and young Jacques Luthi of Switzerland, the bronze. More than a third of the field, 28 racers, including American Steve Mayer, Pete Patterson, and Billy Taylor, either fell or did not finish. And once again, it might be good to go back to last March here on Whiteface Mountain. It was the first run of the giant slalom. Phil Mayer took a terrifying fall, and there was a deep fear and concern he'd never race again. But Phil never had a doubt. And he's written a year-long story of courage and faith in himself. And the final chapter was concluded today. After Ingemar Stenmark, he continues to expand on his legendary exploits. The gold medal that was missed when he fell in Innsbruck is on his way back to Little Carnaby Sweep. And Jacques Luthi, the 20-year-old Swiss racer, takes the bronze. But it has to be a joyous day for the U.S. men's team. Phil Mayer matching the best showing ever by Billy Kidd, dating back to 1964. That's it from Whiteface.
What an achievement,
yes,
for Phil Mayer, coming back from the injury to become only the third American man in Winter Olympics history to win an alpine skiing medal. No American man has ever won a gold. Well, we're going to see the third period of the hockey game, and by the way, you'll be seeing the interview with Ingemar Stenmark and Phil Mayer on our continuing coverage of the Olympics at 11:30 this evening, Eastern Time, a half an hour after our regular program goes off the air. As I said, we're going to see the third period of that hockey game between the United States and the Soviet Union. In the goal, Jim Craig, a doughty, remarkable young man from Massachusetts. Let's meet him. Figure skaters and hockey players are as particular about who grinds their skates as a jeweler is about who cuts his diamonds. Jim Craig swears by his man in Brockton, Mass., and won't let anybody else touch his skates.
Michael, in the outside edge, I don't want it quite as sharp as it was last time because I'm sliding a little bit.
I'll show you how you can do that in the locker room.
Jim's been playing hockey almost as long as he can remember.
Well, we have a pond right back in the house that where I learned how to skate. And my two youngest brothers, Kevin and Danny, would go down there and we'd play hockey until early in the morning until it was dark, and it'd be supper time. My mother would be out there beeping the horn, telling us to get home, and we'd stay out there till our legs were like frostbitting almost, and we'd run home and be crying because it was so cold out, and my mother would just let us eat, and it was all right.
Well, I think my boys were very fortunate. They had a very exceptional mother. She was very dedicated. She spent her life, and her whole life was her boys and her family.
I've never heard anything bad said about my father. He's really honest, and he's doesn't not phony with anybody, and by being that and being the man he is, I just grew to respect him and tried to be just like him. You know, anybody can raise eight kids and suffer like the death of my mother and come through like he has. You know, he's not a quitter.
3 years ago at Christmas time, Jim's mother went to the hospital. We learned at that time that she had about 6 months to live. At that particular time, Jim was going to BU. And it was his first tournament at BU, the Christmas tournament. And Jim came home, and his mother spoke to him, and she told him, and she told each individual member of the family in the little private talk she had. She let them know. She accepted it, She said the 35 years we were married, she had nothing but happiness. She was proud of each and every one of her children. And for Jim to have his pack, his bag and go was very, very difficult at that time for him. But he went down there and they won that tournament. And if I've ever been proud of Jim, it was for the way he carried on, because his mother was as interested in every move that Jim made at that particular time, and it kept her going.
What you've just heard tells you everything you need to know about the Craig family, I think. It also tells you what lies behind the dedication of Jim Craig